Well, good evening. It is good to be with you all this evening. I hope everybody had a good afternoon. And it is good to be back with you this evening to worship our God together. Our call to worship this evening will come from Psalm 100. In our call to worship, we'll see that God himself calls his people into his presence to worship him. There's really a picture of the gospel here. We who are sinners and who are sent out of the garden, sent from God's presence, are now called back into God's presence to worship him. So here, Psalm 100 is our call to worship. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name, for the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. Amen. Well, if you are able, we are now going to sing praise to our God. And if you are able to stand, we are going to stand and sing to God, "To God Be the Glory," which is printed inside your bulletin. There is one who can bring sinful man to an infinitely holy God. So we come through you, Lord Jesus. We pray, Spirit, that you would enable us to worship. We pray that you would bless this time together, and we give you thanks and praise for it. Now, Lord Jesus, we thank you that while you walked on this earth, you were gentle and mild and meek. And we thank you that you taught many things to your people. And we thank you that when you were asked by the disciples how to pray, you did not rebuke them. But you taught the disciples to pray in this way: Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
This evening's corporate affirmation of faith comes from the Westminster Shorter Catechism. The first question and the third question, we'll see in the first question, the reason why God created us. A question that many people hopefully ask themselves and do not know. And then the third question, what Scripture ultimately is about. The first question we see, what is the chief end of man? Man's chief end is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. In question three, we see, what do the Scriptures principally teach? The Scriptures principally teach what man is to believe concerning God and what duty God requires of man. Well, our sermon this evening is going to come from John chapter 1 and verse 29. So if you've brought your own Bible or if you just have the insert there, it is just one verse, but we are going to be looking at several places in the Bible as well. So if you have a Bible, that's great. If you don't, that is great as well, and you will be just fine. But before we read the Scripture, we're going to go to God and ask him to bless this time of reading his word. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we know that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from your mouth. But Father, we pray that you would bless this time in your word. We pray that you would cause your word to be a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. Father, that we would meditate on your word day and night. Would you bless your word to us, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. John chapter 1. Verse 29 reads, The next day he saw Jesus coming toward him and said, Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Now it is said that familiarity breeds contempt, or as one thinker more optimistically put it, familiarity may not breed contempt, but it takes the edge off of admiration. My first time visiting Charlotte, I think it was back in 2014, in the fall, I came and visited Charlotte, and I remember coming in to land at Charlotte, at the airport there in Charlotte, and I could not believe how green it was in Charlotte. And Charlotte is a beautiful city, but you got to remember, I'm coming from Arizona and lived in California before that. I'd been out west. Really, I'd been to Florida, but hadn't been in forever. And it's brown and maybe red in Arizona. And you come to Charlotte, and it's like being in a different world. I came with my dad to check out Reformed Theological Seminary back then in 2014. And I was taking pictures of trees, just trees on the side of the street, and taking pictures of them above a Bojangles or whatever, and sent one of my wife to see these pictures because it was so green and I could not believe it. But again, I was coming from Arizona where you don't, there might be some palm trees and some cactus and stuff like that, but you don't see that. And
We lived for 5 years in Charlotte eventually, and it was great, but by the end of it, I wasn't that blown away by the trees anymore. They were just kind of the landscape. I was in it, and it no longer really fazed me that I lived in a beautiful area that is very lush and green. Well, if you're anything like me, perhaps you can say that, as I can say, that familiarity with the Bible or certain truths in the Bible can lead us to maybe not being contemptible of them, but maybe not being as astonished by these truths as we ought to be. And this evening, I want to look at this one particular truth that we just read, and that is while Jesus, while he is many things, and while during his ministry here on earth involved many duties, involved a lot of different things, Jesus, first and foremost, is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So the man who uttered these words, we just read verse 29, it says the next day he saw Jesus. If we look back, it's John the Baptist. John the Baptist sees Jesus and he utters these words that this is God's Lamb. Now, John was the first prophet that the Jews had in 400 years. So just imagine that. Malachi, as far as we know, at least in terms of a prophet who wrote anything down, Malachi is the last prophet in the Old Testament. And the people of Israel have been told by God that he was going to send them a savior. He was going to send them one who was going to set them free. He was going to send them one who was going to come and right the wrongs. He was going to punish the wicked, and he was going to reward his people. He was going to reward the righteous. And God's people would live in peace and never again have to worry about being bothered by anybody. So 400 years pass, and no prophet comes. The people continue to wait. And then we see in John's gospel the appearance of John the Baptist. So we see the herald, not the Lamb of God, but the herald of the Lamb of God. And we're going to look at that actually in verses 19 through 27, the one who's going to herald the coming of the Lamb of God. So John the Baptist shows up in the wilderness outside the land of Judah. Now he's dressed like a prophet. He's acting like a prophet. He's speaking like a prophet. In fact, Mark tells us that John appeared baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, when Mark says that all the people were going out to see John, of course, he's not saying that every man, woman, and child in Judea and in Jerusalem were going out to see Jesus. He's not saying all the Pharisees went out and were baptized, and that Pilate came and went, or that Herod went out. That's not what he's saying. But what John is saying is that, or what Mark is saying, is that there was such a stir, there was such a commotion that was caused, there's so much anticipation that was caused by John the Baptist, that you could say, in effect, that the entire city came out to see him. It'd be as if the Panthers were to win the Super Bowl, if that were to happen someday, and they have a big parade in Charlotte, and they say the entire city came out to see the Panthers and to congratulate them on their win. Of course, they're not saying every single person, but it was a big deal. People were coming out to see this one who's acting and speaking like a prophet. In fact, John had such a great impact on the people that Luke's gospel tells us that they began to think that John was the Messiah. People started to wonder, is this one who's preaching for us to repent? Maybe this is the one we've been waiting for. This is the Messiah. And John responds to them, I baptize you with water, but he who is mightier than I is coming, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Now, John does exactly what a good prophet, what a good herald is supposed to do. And that's, he does not point people to himself, but he does point people to Jesus. Now, even the religious leaders of the day came out to see what John was doing and why he's acting the way that he was. And in John's Gospel, the verses prior to our text for this evening, it says that some Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem out to John to ask him what he's doing. This is probably an official delegation sent from Jerusalem to find out who this guy is that's out by the river baptizing people. And baptism was generally what we think is what John was doing. This is when Gentiles would want to become Jews. The Gentiles were dirty. They were unclean. They would be baptized to show that they're leaving their pagan ways behind them and coming into God's people. And John is out here telling everybody, the Jews, that they need to do this as well to prepare for the Messiah to come. So they send a delegation out to him. They ask him, they say, "Who are you?" And verse 20 tells us that John confessed and did not deny, but confessed and said, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" And he said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." So John, again, does not point to himself at all. He points to Christ. Now, these questions are interesting that they asked John. The first thing that they asked him was if he was the Christ. Now, the people were waiting for the Christ. This is just the Greek word for Messiah. They're waiting for this one, this anointed one, that God promised in the Old Testament that he was going to send. And in verse 20, John flat out denies that he's the Christ. They say, "Are you the Christ?" And they say, "Who are you?" And he says, "I'm not the Christ. If that's what you're thinking, you're wrong. I'm not the Christ." Secondly, the people are wondering if he's Elijah in verse 21. Now, that might sound weird. Why were they asking him if he was Elijah? But as you read the Old Testament, as the people had been waiting for these 400 years for God to speak to them, you remember the last book we just said a minute ago that we have in the Bible that was written was Malachi. And Malachi talks about this coming day of the Lord, that he is going to come, that there will be this day on which the wicked will be judged. In Malachi, he talks about them being burned as in an oven, and that God's people will go out rejoicing and stomping on their ashes. And he tells them to remember the law of Moses until that time. People had strayed far from it. But then he tells them that before this great and awesome day comes, that he is going to send somebody to them, not the Messiah, but he's going to send somebody to them who is going to get the people ready, this forerunner. And in Malachi chapter 4, this is, if you're in Matthew's gospel and just flip over one page, this is what you would see. But God, through Malachi, says, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction." So it's actually not surprising that they would ask John the Baptist if he was Elijah. Actually, what is surprising is that he denies that he's Elijah. And we see in other parts of the gospel narratives that they're asking about Elijah coming after they're on the Mount of Transfiguration and they're coming down, and James and Peter and John have seen Jesus transfigured before them, and they're saying, why did the teacher say that Elijah comes first? And Jesus tells them that Elijah does come first, and he then explains to them that John the Baptist was in fact Elijah. So again, what is interesting is not that they ask John the Baptist if he is Elijah. What's interesting is that he says he's not Elijah. And most likely the reason that he's doing this is that there started to be the belief that God literally was going to send Elijah the prophet. So Elijah from 1 Kings, and that he was going to come back. And they had wrong expectations for John the Baptist, this forerunner prophet, like they had wrong expectations for Jesus as the Messiah. And then the third thing we see is that the people were waiting for the prophet. The prophet. In verse 21, they asked John the Baptist if he's the prophet, and he answers no. And certainly what the people were thinking of here is back to Deuteronomy. Moses is getting ready to die. Deuteronomy is really Moses' farewell address to the people. Joshua is going to take my place. I'm going to die. You're going into the promised land. Trust God. Joshua, you be strong. Everybody, follow Joshua. And by the way, in Deuteronomy 18:15, he says, "The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen." So they're almost certainly thinking of this when they talk to John and they say, "Are you the prophet?" They're thinking of this great prophet who will come, who will be like Moses and will lead God's people. Now, though John is the forerunner spoken of in Malachi, we never see him pointing to himself. In fact, if anything, John downplays who he is. Now, John would have no doubt from his parents have heard the stories about his father that we read about in Luke's gospel. Zechariah is an older man and a priest. If you remember, Zechariah and Elizabeth are married and they have no children. And they want to have children, but they have none. And Zechariah is chosen to go into the temple and to burn incense. And Gabriel shows up to him and tells him that your prayer has been heard. And you are going to have a child, and he is going to be the forerunner of the Messiah. There's no doubt that John would have known. My father told me that God told him this is who I am. I am this forerunner to the Messiah. He would have been told that Elizabeth would have a son. So John knows who he is. And John knew that he was this herald of Christ. But as a good herald, again, John does not direct attention to himself. He's very quick to let people know, I'm not the one you're waiting for. The one who you're waiting for is coming after me. He directs all attention to Jesus. And about himself, John has just this to say in verse 23. When he finally does say something about himself, he says, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as the prophet Isaiah said." As I heard one preacher say, John is in effect saying that he himself is nothing. He's just a voice. Now, while John emphatically denies that he's anybody special, we see him say that the one who comes after him is somebody who's special. He is somebody that will be the Christ. He is the one. He is this prophet that Moses spoke about. He is coming after him. He's this one who will usher in this great age, or this great day of salvation. In verse 27, he says, "I baptize with water," verse 26, "but among you stands one you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." So while John points away from himself, he wants people to know, this one who is coming, you need to focus all of your attention on him. Now, it's in this context, 400 years of silence, being ruled by a foreign army. The Roman Empire was now here in the land of Judah. And a prophet coming on the scene and emphatically declaring that God's chosen one is about to come, that Jesus comes on the scene. And we come to the verse that I read at the beginning that you have in your bulletin, verse 29, where we read, "The next day he saw Jesus coming to him and said, 'Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world.'" Now, again, certainly John could have said many things about Jesus, the great teacher, the prophet, everything else that we said. But the most important thing for John, for people to know about Jesus, is that this coming one, he is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. So my question for us tonight is, what did John mean by that? By the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Now, there are, strangely enough, people who really debate this. And I think it's clear when you read the Old Testament that this picture of a lamb is all over the place. And it's in Jewish society all over the place. Now, I guess the reason people wonder why John is talking about this is the fact that John later on seems to be perplexed when he is in prison, and then as he's going to be executed. And the belief is that John believed that Jesus was the Messiah, but he didn't know that Jesus was going to die in the way he is. And actually, I mean, there might be some credence to that, because John, of course, is surprised when he is in prison, but he knew that Jesus was going to deal with sin in some way. So he refers to Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And the first image that brings up is the Passover lamb that was sacrificed in the book of Exodus. Of course, you know, God is bringing his people out of Egypt. They're in bondage. They're in slavery. God sends Moses. He's going to bring them out. He sends plagues on the Egyptians. The Egyptians are going to be judged for mistreating his people. Of course, Pharaoh is going to be judged for not listening to God. And when the last plague comes, God tells his people, take a lamb. They could take a sheep or a goat, but take a lamb. You are to kill this Passover lamb. You are to take some of its blood. You are to put it on your doorposts. And then when the destroyer, the angel, moves through the camp, if he sees your house has got the blood there, he's going to pass over. He will pass by your house. He will not be allowed in to destroy the firstborn son. And of course, this is where we get the word Passover, is that he will pass by. He will not destroy the ones who have this mark of the blood of the lamb on their doorposts. The Jews were to do this every year. This was the one celebration that the Jewish people were all to go to Jerusalem for every year. There were a lot of celebrations. There were a lot of feast days that the Jews celebrated. But there was one time in the year that all the people, if they were able, were to go to Jerusalem. And that was on the Passover. So the Passover rite was celebrated every year, much like we celebrate Easter. And a lamb was slaughtered every year in place of the people so that they would not be destroyed. So the Jews would celebrate or remember the great deliverance of their forefathers by sacrificing a lamb and smearing its blood so that God would spare them. And the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians thinks about this, and he says that this, of course, has been fulfilled in Jesus. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, right in the middle of talking about church discipline, right in the middle of talking about serious issues going on in the church in Corinth, there's great sin in the church in Corinth. And Paul is telling them, you need to get the sin out of your church, but you need to celebrate. Let us start the celebration, not with the leaven. He's talking about sin here. But then Paul says this. He says, for Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Jesus Christ is the fulfillment of the Passover. Now imagine being a Jew who would celebrate the Passover every year. Okay, the Passover is still the biggest holiday, even for secular Jews, non-believing Jews. Passover is like Christmas, or like I said, a better thing is it's like Easter, obviously. And they celebrate it every year. But if you were a Jew during this time, you'd go to Jerusalem and you'd see animals being slaughtered. I'm not really a big fan of movies that are to depict the life of Jesus. I think it generally breaks the second commandment. But whenever you see the movies, and it's supposed to be the time of Christ and whatever's going on, you see the temple and the Pharisees around the temple, they never leave in the part about what was going on in the temple. And the fact of the matter is, on any given day at the temple, it's estimated that there were up to 1,500 animals being sacrificed every day at the temple. It was an extremely bloody place. In fact, they had troughs that were built underneath the altar to lead away from the temple because they're, it's kind of gory, but there's so much blood that it was to take the blood away down into the ravines and the places near there. And you can imagine if you're sacrificing 1,500 animals a day. So there was blood everywhere. It was a very bloody ritual that was being done. You'd see this if you went to Jerusalem. And you can imagine at some point in your life, you'd start to wonder, what on earth is the point of these animals that we are sacrificing? I mean, is God just really into seeing animals be sacrificed? So after 400 years of silence, a prophet comes on the scene and declares, behold, the Lamb of God. Secondly, the ram or lamb that Abraham offered in place of Isaac back in Genesis chapter 22. Every Jewish person not only was to celebrate the Passover every year, but every Jewish person growing up would know the stories of their Old Testament, their Bible. They would know all the stories, but they would certainly know the story, one of the biggest stories for Jewish people in the Bible, the story of Abraham and Isaac. Of course, Abraham is told in Genesis 22 to go and sacrifice his son Isaac. And what is interesting is Isaac asks his father where the sacrifice is. In the Jewish world, the kind of hero of that story is actually Isaac to this day. Isaac is seen as the great one of faith because he willingly gives himself to be sacrificed. But we aren't really told that. But Isaac does ask his father in Genesis 22, verse 7. He asks his father, "Behold, the fire and the wood, but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" So Isaac asks his father Abraham. They've walked for 3 days. They're going to Mount Moriah. They're about to do the sacrifice. He asks his father, "We've got everything, but we don't have the lamb." Now, Pastor Rick Phillips, some of you might know Rick Phillips. He's the lead pastor at Second Presbyterian Church in Greenville. Pastor Rick Phillips says this. I think he's right on with this. He says, "The entire Old Testament can be summed up in Isaac's question, where is the lamb? The true lamb. The one who is really going to pay for our sins." Ever since Adam and Eve fell in the garden, mankind has needed somebody to pay for our sins that we might be forgiven. Of course, God clothed Adam and Eve, and the ram or the lamb was sacrificed in place of Isaac. Then you have the whole sacrificial system of the Old Testament. Again, 1,500 animals a day or more being sacrificed because of sin. Animals dying because of sin in the place of people. Now, the animals were never meant to actually take away the sin of the people. It did not actually atone for the people. It did not make their relationship with God right. In Hebrews chapter 10, the author says, "It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away his sins. An animal cannot pay for the sins of a human being." Only a human being can pay for the sins of a human being. So we saw when John speaks of the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, he's almost certainly thinking about the sacrificial system in the Old Testament, instituted at the Passover and then through the Mosaic Law. He's thinking of Isaac and Abraham in Genesis 22. But then thirdly, I think he's thinking of the suffering servant of Isaiah chapter 53. Now, my mother-in-law, my wife's mother, was raised in a conservative Jewish family. She had a bat mitzvah where when you're 12, I can't remember if it's 12 or 13, but kind of your coming of age if you are Jewish, a bar mitzvah if you're a boy, bat mitzvah if you're really serious for the girls, and they then become old enough to be responsible for the law and for the boys, and they can be part of the quorum of a synagogue. But she was raised in a Jewish family, and she would go to the synagogue on the Sabbath on Saturdays. And in a synagogue, to this day, they have prescribed readings, kind of like in an Anglican church, or in many churches, they'll have actually a church calendar where you read certain portions of the scripture on certain days, and they had that in Jesus' day as well. And to this day, however, part of the yearly reading, you do read Isaiah chapter 52, and you do read Isaiah chapter 54, but they do not read Isaiah chapter 53, and in fact, my mother-in-law was converted, at least partially, by Isaiah chapter 53. I mean, when you read Isaiah chapter 53 and you look at it, it is so clear that this is talking about Jesus. Actually, in my ninth grade class, teaching at Dillon Christian School, we were talking about Jesus as the Lamb of God. We were talking about Isaiah, and we watched a little video clip of in Israel talking with Jews, and there's a man, there's this one ministry there, and it's for Jews who have been converted to Christ. And one of the things they do is they're in Jerusalem and Tel Aviv and other places, and they're trying to get Jewish people to read Isaiah. They're doing it all in Hebrew, but to read Isaiah chapter 53. And to the person, every single one after they read it will say, I've never heard of that before in my life. And Isaiah chapter 53 speaks so clearly about Christ. In verses 6 and 7, it says this about this one who is living for the people. It says, all we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he opened not his mouth. This innocent one who will suffer for the people. Now, what's interesting, just like in Jesus' day, is people will read this and they're like, oh, this is clearly somebody who died for the people in his place, everything else. And then they'll talk about, okay, well, I'm a Christian, and immediately say, I don't want to hear anything about that, even though it is so clearly talking about Jesus. Well, the Apostle Peter talks about this as well, telling believers who are being persecuted to know that they were not purchased, they were not rescued by money. They were purchased by something much greater than money. They were purchased by the precious blood of Christ. He says, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. So I guess the big question I now have going over those three themes, those three areas in the Old Testament, there are a lot more of them that speak of one being in the place of others, a lamb standing in the place of sinners. What is the big deal? He's the Lamb of God. What does that mean for us? And I'll happily quote Rick Phillips again when he said the entire Old Testament can be summarized by Isaac's question, where is the Lamb? He then again says the entire New Testament answers that question by Abraham's statement that the Lord will provide the lamb. Isaac asks, Father, where is the lamb? And Abraham responds, the Lord will provide the lamb. Or as John the Baptist stated in our verse this morning, this evening, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus was a masterful teacher. Jesus could teach in a way that nobody else could teach. Jesus was the perfect, sinless, perfect example of faithfulness to God, of trust in God, of sacrificial living, of love, of giving his life for those who hated him. But more than anything, Jesus came to give his life for sinners. Now, there's a theologian who I cut my teeth on after being converted. His name is Don Carson, and he has an excellent commentary on John's gospel, and I'm going to read a quote by him, which I think really gets to the point here. He says, if God had perceived that our greatest need was economic, he would have sent an economist. If he had perceived that our greatest need was entertainment, he would have sent us a comedian or an artist. If God had perceived that our greatest need was political stability, he would have sent us a politician. If he had perceived that our greatest need was health, he would have sent us a doctor. But he perceived that our greatest need involved our sin, our alienation from him, our profound rebellion, our death, and he sent us a savior. We need help in many areas in our world and our own lives personally. But our greatest need is for a Savior. Mankind's greatest need is for a Savior. When we pray for our country, I am very much, I'm as aware as anybody here that things do not look good and that there are dark clouds on the horizon potentially. And I do not want to downplay our political process and other things. I'd be as involved as you can be. However, what our country needs more than anything is a Savior. We need people to know the Lord Jesus Christ. So why? Why do we need a Lamb of God? Why can't God just forgive sins? Why can't God just forgive us? I mean, did Jesus really have to die? Well, God is just. God must punish sin because our sin deserves punishment. God cannot wink at our sin or just brush it away. There are two truths that we must look at. God will punish all sin. All sin will be punished. Now, God can forgive you and me and still be just only if somebody else pays for our sin. Somebody must pay for our sin. Now, this might sound like the ABCs of Christianity, and it is, but I have found, at least with youth, and actually it's not just with youth, but in a lot of Bible-believing churches and people who have grown up in church, that when you ask them why Jesus died on the cross, and they'll say, well, because God loves us when you get to, no, but why did he actually have to go to the cross and die? People quite often still think that Jesus' primary reason for going to the cross, or even the only reason he went to the cross, was as an example for us of love. Now, Jesus did go to the cross as an example of love. Jesus did go to the cross for many different reasons. But the main reason, the number one reason why Jesus went to the cross is that there is no other way that sinful people like you and me could be forgiven by a holy God unless somebody pays for our sins. We are guilty. Somebody has to pay. That is either us individually in hell forever, or that is another human being, a perfect human being, willingly dying in our place. The only way that God can forgive guilty people and even declare them as righteous without it being not true is if one died in their place. And Paul brings this up in the book of Romans. He talks about that God sent Jesus to die to atone for the sins of the people. And he says that this was to show God's righteousness because in his divine forbearance, he had passed over former sins. It was to show his righteousness, again, God's righteousness, at the present time so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. If you look at any system of belief, any religion in the world, apart from Christianity, it is you getting yourself into heaven, you doing this, you do enough stuff, you are righteous, you get in because basically you deserve it, and maybe God is a little, he grades on a curve and he's going to let you in. Christianity is the only religion, the system of belief, that says God accepts us not because of us. It has nothing to do with us. God took the initiative. God sent his son who died in our place. We're not worthy of going to heaven. But God offers salvation because he did it, not us. And he's just because he still has punished our sins in Christ on the cross. Now, when it talks about God passing over former sins, remember that this is talking about people who died before Christ, before the Son of God became man, before the incarnation. So imagine a good guy. Imagine David. Okay, David's a good guy. David's in heaven right now, right? David is a good guy. David did some horrible things. I mean, can you imagine if you're Uriah? You're one of David's most faithful soldiers, and you're out fighting, and then you find out, well, Uriah's in glory now, but can you imagine if you were to find out this great guy who's in heaven now, he slept with my wife, and then he called me back to try to cover it up, and then he had me killed out on the battlefield. You'd say, that's not, and then he's in glory. That's not fair. David needs to pay for his sin. Now, David is a sinner, and we are sinners. And the way that God can actually say that David is forgiven, it's not because David's own child, I realize David's child died, but the fact is that Christ died for David's sins. David is a sinner who's forgiven because the Lamb of God died for him. Now, the last place I'm going to turn very briefly before closing is to Revelation chapter 5. Now, John, the same writer who wrote the Gospel of John, wrote the book of Revelation. And in Revelation chapter 5, John is in God's throne room. And John is in heaven, he's in glory. And he can't believe this. And people are angels and myriads of angels and strange looking things to us are praising God and saying, "Worthy are you." And it's just this amazing picture of worship of God. And then we see one who's sitting on the throne, speaking about the Father, sitting on the throne and having a scroll in his right hand. And no one is able to open it because nobody is worthy. And John begins to weep because no one is found worthy anywhere in heaven or on earth or under the earth to open the scroll and to open its seals. This would be the unfolding of God's redemptive plan, opening these seals. Nobody is found worthy. No angel, nothing is worthy. So John begins to weep. He is crying profusely. And in verse 5 of chapter 5 of the book of Revelation, an angel tells John not to weep anymore. He says, "Because behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." So the Lion conquering, the Root of David, this king. We expect to see this Lion on the scene. And in verse 6, it says that John looks and he sees between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain. He's told that the lion has conquered, and he looks, and R.C. Sproul said, you expect to see Aslan jump onto the scene, this great lion, and he looks, and he sees a lamb. I think a lamb is probably the most pathetic animal on the face of the earth. I don't think they can protect themselves from anything. And he sees a lamb standing as if it had been slain. But this is the lion. Jesus is not half lion and half lamb. He is the lion and he is the lamb. Jesus did conquer. And Jesus conquered, and he conquered death by dying. Not coming as the Jews or the Romans believed, this one riding his white steed who was going to trample everybody under his feet and flex his muscles as he did it. He did it by coming and giving himself for sinners like you and me. After Jesus takes the scroll from the hand of God, the elders in the heavenly throne room sing a new song. They say, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." Brothers and sisters in Christ, if you are a sinner, God has provided a lamb that you might be forgiven. Brothers and sisters, our Lord Jesus Christ is many things, but may we not forget that our Lord Jesus Christ is the one who has taken away our sins. You may think that your sin is too great. The Bible says that Jesus is the answer to your sin. But my question in closing is, have you ever felt the burden of your sins? That you are sinful, that you are guilty against God? That if God is just, you should, in fact, be cut off from God because you do, in fact, need to be, you are guilty. I was 25 years old. It was right when I turned 25, when God opened my eyes to see that I was a sinner. You know, my biggest thing in my life was that I was being a good person. Always thinking I was a good person. And it literally took a miracle where God opens your eyes to see, I've done some bad things, but where you're not protecting yourself anymore, you realize I'm guilty. You come to the realization that I need God to forgive, I need help. And my question is, have you ever had that realization? And then my question is, do you know that God has provided for you? You can bring your guilt to God because Jesus lived and died for all who would put their trust in him and repent and believe in him. My prayer is that those of us who have done that would praise God, and those, if any of their if there's anybody who has not done that, that you would realize your sin and realize that there is a loving Savior who offers you a free and full salvation. Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, we praise your name. We give thanks that you still do open the eyes of the blind to their sin. Father, we thank you that as we read the Bible, we don't see anybody ever coming to the Lord Jesus and asking for forgiveness and then being turned away. And Father, we confess that the problem is we don't see the need to be forgiven. And it's not that we don't need to be forgiven, it's that we're blind to our own wickedness. Father, we thank you that you do bring life where there's death. We thank you that you gave your Son that we might be forgiven. Lord, would we praise the Lamb of God? Would we remember that we have a Savior who reigns in heaven? We thank you and we pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. Well, I think a fitting hymn to respond to this message is printed in your bulletin, and it is Jesus Paid It All. Jesus did pay for all our sin on the cross. And if you are able, let us stand and sing this as a response to God for his grace. Doxology. Let us pray. Our Father, we thank you for this day, your day, the Lord's day in which we can gather together. Our Father, we thank you for your word. We pray that you would strengthen us as we go. We pray that we would walk worthy this week, remembering that our Savior is in heaven, our righteousness in heaven. Father, may we walk as children, sons and daughters of the King of Glory. Would you be with us as we go? We pray in Christ's name.
Thank you.